For the second time in 5 weeks, SpaceX has rolled Starship's first Orbital-class Super Heavy booster, from its Starbase factory to the launch pad, ahead of a challenging and multifaceted test campaign. Deemed Super Heavy Booster, the 69 meters tall rocket first rolled to the launch pad around August 3rd, after SpaceX technicians fitted it with 29 Raptor engines in a single night. Followed by Orbital-class Starship prototype S-20 a few days later, the two stages of a Starship were stacked to their full height on August 6, briefly creating the largest rocket ever assembled. Ship 20 was then quickly returned to the build site, where SpaceX workers completed an additional approximately 10 days of finishing touches, mainly focused on avionics wiring and secondary plumbing. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk says that the plan is to not only cryoproof the first flightworthy Super Heavy, but to static fire the booster and shake down Starship's brand new orbital launch complex as early as next week. A lot of work would need to be finished, and all of it smoothly, for an orbital launch pad cryoproof and static fire to be possible just a week or less from now. But Musk's response nevertheless provides invaluable context for SpaceX's near-term plans, and confirms that Super Heavy Booster 4 is ready for integrated testing as is. Further, Musk's tweet implies, as speculated, that Starbase's orbital launch complex tank farm is much closer to test readiness than it might otherwise appear. Both Super Heavy Booster 4B4 and the launch mount have undergone substantial changes since they last parted ways 4 weeks ago. SpaceX teams have been laser-focused on installing the vast array of plumbing, wiring, and components required to turn the hulking steel structures into functional launch facilities, and the largest flightworthy rocket, and both certainly look the part. Unlike Starship, which has an expansive skirt section perfect for stowing away sensitive plumbing and avionics, Super Heavy has an unusually short interstage and no real skirt. Meaning that all the extra hardware SpaceX has installed over the last month or so is impossible to hide. Indeed, when Booster 4 rolled out of Starbase's high bay for the second time on September 8, the rocket was blanketed by dozens of new valves, thousands of feet of wiring and plumbing, pressure vessels, multiple hydraulic racks, a quick disconnect umbilical panel for interfacing with the launch pad, places for flight termination system, FTS, explosive charges to be installed, and much, much more. Additionally, Super Heavy B-FA's second batch of 29 Raptors, installed in late August, also appear to all have outward-facing umbilical panels that will allow the booster to receive some level of assistance from ground systems while igniting those engines. It's unclear what exactly they'll do, but it's likely that those engine umbilical will connect to high-pressure gas systems on the ground, presumably minimizing the already absurd amount of COPVs and secondary plumbing present on Super Heavy. However, Super Heavy will still need to be able to reignite anywhere from 1 to 13 of its 29 to 32 Raptor engines in flight for boostback and landing burns, potentially explaining the 8 large pressure vessels and 100 plus small, high-pressure gas lines installed on B-FA's aft end. Super Heavy also needs to be able to chill, feed, and purge all 29 to 32 of its Raptor engines, guaranteeing that Starship's booster plumbing situation was going to be immensely complex, no matter the approach SpaceX took. In addition to Super Heavy B-FA's newfound complexity, SpaceX also spent the last 4 or so weeks outfitting Starbase's orbital launch mount with all the plumbing, power, avionics, and mechanical systems it will need to function as Stage 0 of Orbital Class 2-stage Starship rockets. SpaceX has installed most of the secondary quick disconnect structures that will connect to and feed each of Super Heavy's 20 outer Raptor engines. The main Super Heavy quick disconnect device was also installed, and a team has been gradually outfitting and connecting the structure to the plumbing, avionics, and power it will provide boosters. A significant amount of work still remains to connect the orbital launch mount to SpaceX's incomplete and custom-built orbital tank farm, which will store, super cool, and feed the pad, Super Heavy, and Starship with several thousand metric tons of liquid and gaseous oxygen, and methane. It's difficult to say how close Starbase's tank farm is to being able to support Starship or Super Heavy testing, which makes it equally unclear what SpaceX's near-term plans are for Booster 4. It's possible that the rocket has been reinstalled on the orbital launch mount as a second fit check, perhaps focused on those 20 outer Raptor quick disconnect mechanisms. It's also possible that the tank farm and launch mount plumbing are much closer to completion than expected. Meaning that Super Heavy B-4 could remain at the orbital pad, until it's completed several crucial cryogenic proof and static fire tests. Of course, short of confirmation from Musk himself, we'll just have to wait and see. SpaceX has reinstalling 3 of the 6 Raptor engines on Starship SN20, that will power the first orbital-class Starship and repairing the heat shield, that will hopefully protect it on its first trip to space. Known as Starship 20 or S20, the 50 meters tall steel rocket prototype has been stationed at one of SpaceX's 2 suborbital testing pads, since August 13. No testing has been done, though, and a small army of SpaceX technicians and engineers have instead spent the last 3, or so weeks effectively turning a collection of steel tanks, tubes, and parts into a functional rocket. While it's unclear why SpaceX chose to do that outfitting work at an unsheltered launch pad, new activity suggests that it may be almost complete. Exactly 1 month ago, SpaceX stacked Starship S20 on top of Super Heavy Booster 4, on August 6, briefly creating the largest rocket in history, and completing a fit test that was admittedly just as much a photo op. Ship 20 was rapidly destacked and returned to SpaceX's Starbase factory, where all 6 of its Raptor engines were removed. About a week later, Ship 20 returned to the pad and has remained installed on suborbital pad B ever since. At the time, the implication was that SpaceX had removed Ship 20's engines to allow the prototype to complete cryogenic proof testing with hydraulic thrust simulators. However, despite having carefully modified Pad B over several weeks for that exact purpose, those modifications were rapidly removed before Ship 20's second rollout. Now, even that appears to have been P1 recluded. Instead, as if Ship 20 were the second or third or fourth in a series of prototypes. SpaceX rolled 3 Center Raptors to Pad B on September 5, and began installing the engines on Starship on the 6th. It's hard to say anything with confidence, given how chaotically Starship S20's to be determined qualification testing has changed in the last several weeks. But, with plenty of uncertainty, Raptor installation implies that the vehicle will perform its first ambient pressure and cryogenic proof tests with engines installed. It remains to be seen if Ship 20's 3 vacuum-optimized Raptor engines will also be installed over the next few days. Seemingly the logical assumption, or if SpaceX will instead complete proof tests and center Raptor static fire testing, before finally moving into new territory. SpaceX has never static fired more than 3 Raptors at once, and certainly never tested multiple Raptor vacuum RVAC engines, in close proximity, let alone all 6 simultaneously. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.